You're listening to the Final Draft Insider View. I'm your host, Pete D'Alessandro, and we're going to be talking to a very exciting screenwriter, director today. You know her from everything, Julie Delpy. Julie, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
So credits include lots of stuff. The Three Colors trilogy, the Before Sunset Sunrise trilogy, 2 Days in Paris, which she wrote, directed, and acted in, and 2 Days in New York. She was in Avengers Age of Ultron, ER, and I know that you're developing something for a new streaming service, On the Verge?
Yeah. I'm not sure it's going to happen. You know, when you develop projects like that, you never know who's going to go for it. I mean, if they're going to go for it. So we'll see, you know, but I'm developing something right now, yeah.
That's exciting. Okay, cool. Well, the first thing I'd like to start out with, I know you grew up in a theater family. Was there a moment in your life when you knew this was going to be your career?
Writing and directing and doing more than, you know, I had very low expectation from life. I was writing since an early age, and I was, you know, writing little short stories, mostly sci-fi. I was kind of like a sci-fi fan and grew up reading a lot of sci-fi and spending my life watching sci-fi films and all sorts of films, actually. And basically, you know, I started writing my first screenplay. I was 15 years old. And I tried to make it into a film, but, you know, obviously no one wanted to give money to a 16. I was 16 by the time I dropped it off. I dropped it at the CNC, which is the way of financing small films in France through the government and all that stuff. But, you know, like actually people wanted to publish it, like, you know, into a novel. And then I gave up because I really wanted to make it into a film, but no one wanted to do it. So I gave up on that one. And then I kept on writing, you know. Wrote a lot of stuff before, you know, I always say I wrote my first screenplay at 16 and had my first film made at 36. So it took me 20 years, you know.
So overnight success.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm curious, what was that first screenplay about? And what was the inspiration for that?
You know, the first screenplay, it was in French, obviously. And it was called The Idiot's Duty. And it was actually a weird version of Alice in Wonderland. Set in Paris, very serious, you know, when you're 16, you're very serious. And it was kind of a romantic story between a young man and a young woman. And it was all set underground and kind of like Alice in Wonderland, but a very, very weird, dark version of it.
That sounds it really was, cool.
Yeah, it was, you know, I read it recently. It was it's really dark. I was like, oh my God.
So not the comedies that you've gravitated towards more lately.
No. Like the dark side of me, you know.
Okay.
Teenagers, you know.
What was the inspiration for that? Was it just Alice in Wonderland? Was that what it came from?
Yeah. I was kind of obsessed with Alice in Wonderland as a kid because, I don't know. I just love the world of kind of magic and dark at the same time and kind of scary and dreams and all that, you know?
Right. Surreal.
Yeah. Surreal. I love surreal stuff.
So in that 20 year span and all the time since you got your first movie, I mean, you've learned a lot about writing, but there aren't a lot of, you don't get an awful lot of chances in life to write and direct and star in something all at once. What's different when you're doing that rather than just writing for a character or writing for yourself as a director? When you're doing all three, what changes?
Well, you know, you have to sort of know that you're going to put aside the writer in you eventually when you start directing the film and just think about what works and what doesn't work. Because as a writer, sometimes you can be attached to certain things, but you kind of have to let go of it when you're directing. You know, it's just a different job, and it's kind of like you want to almost, for me, I kind of take the screenplay that I write and try to forget that I wrote it in a way. Mm. And same thing with acting, you know, I kind of try to forget that I'm directing or that I've, you know, written the screenplay. I mean, it's hard to forget I'm directing since I'm doing both at the same time. But, you know, sure. I try not to think about it too much and just do it. It's a funny thing. Like you don't want to be too attached to the screenplay in a way. And that's it. I mean, I don't know how I do it actually. I don't think about it too much. I think that's probably the secret, you know.
That's a good call. Well, let me ask the reverse of that question. When you're, I don't know, I couldn't tell if have you done this, you pick up someone else's screenplay to direct. Has that been a different process for you?
I've never done that. I've co-wrote, but I was usually pretty involved in the writing when I co-wrote things. Mm-hmm. And no, I've never done that yet.
Do you feel like that's something you'd be interested in, or it's just not something that appeals to you?
Well, for now, I'm doing my own films that I write, just because I have so many screenplays that I've written that I want to make my films. And, you know, kind of like, I kind of like the idea that it's kind of like my own thing for now. And, you know, maybe later, you know, I'm open to, I mean, listen, so far I'm not in a position where, you know, really, really great screenplay are being sent to me. Mm-hmm. So whenever that happens, you know, I'll consider, you know.
You said you have a lot of screenplays of your own. I'm curious, how do you have a kind of a regular routine of cranking stuff out? Does it happen twice a year, three times a year for you?
No, not. I've been writing for a long time. So I have a lot of screenplays that never got made that I wrote over the 20 years that I was waiting to make a movie, you know.
That's great.
So, you know, I have one, two, three, I don't know, I have like about 8 screenplays. All very, very, very different comedies, drama, sci-fi, anything you can think of. Oh,
that's great.
Some good, some bad.
Yeah, I guess we all have those. We have that mix if we're lucky.
Maybe what they have in common is like they're not very common, let's say. The subject matter, the characters, it's pretty crazy. I mean, some of them are pretty crazy. I don't know.
Sure.
I don't know. Some are unmakeable, probably, like unshootable, you know.
Those are always the most fun to write, though, aren't they?
Yeah, you know. Maybe I should make a comic book out of one of them, so.
That would be really exciting. I'd love to see that. Mm-hmm. Well, how has being a director, that you get to see the end process of this, how has that influenced any of your other writing that you're doing? I mean, you get to see an edit and you get to watch a film evolve long past that writing point. What do you take back to the next project after doing that so many times?
After directing and writing? And mm-hmm. What do you mean? Like,
like you've seen how a story that you imagined on paper has evolved into something.
Comes to life. Yeah, it's interesting because I don't really think too much about it because really, I mean, what's happening is that when I write, I really visualize things. Mm-hmm. Probably that's why I would only write screenplay, you know, because it always comes with visuals and sound. Mm. I mean, I hear people talking, you know. Not literally, I mean, I'm not, you know, crazy, but, you know, I actually really hear the dialogue being said, and I visualize everything kind of, you know, to the colors, the props, the way it's cut, the way it's edited. I hear the music sometimes even, you know. Then when I go into shooting the film, it usually comes close as I can possibly get it to what was in my head. I have very, very clear visuals, and I usually pick sets, actors, costumes based on what I was imagining from the start.
So you're not looking at major rewrites when you do a movie when you're editing. That's not drastically changing for you, it sounds like.
In the editing room? No.
That's
no.
Great.
Usually, and sometimes I remember when I did 2 days in Paris, the ending, I needed all that footage of Adam Goldberg improvising bits because in the screenplay, it was written with a voiceover over him talking, but not really hearing what he was saying. And, you know, when we did the improvisation, I think Adam was thinking, oh, I'm going to change the ending and make it like really like the improvisation stuff. And, you know, I'm not crazy for improvisation always, mm-hmm. but it was exactly what I needed for that moment to cover it with my voiceover. And I think he was not super happy with that in the end. You know, he was like, how come you got away with my best moment? But it was written that way, meaning I write it and I stick to the writing in the end, usually.
That's great.
I very rarely end up changing major things, you know, maybe a word there and there, you know, especially when I work with my dad because I can't really control him. But my dad is a fantastic actor, but he's also kind of a handful. And but outside of him, really, everything is super written, you know, from the start. I can do tons of rewrites before I shoot. Mm-hmm. That's something different. And also sometimes on set, when I feel a scene doesn't work, I'm going to change something and stuff. But I usually, whatever, you know, it's pretty much the screenplay.
I mean, that's a great answer because most people seem not to have that same sort of discipline to that initial vision for one reason.
You know, it takes me a while to put movies together, so I get to really, really work on them. And I like to have a ready script. Like, I don't like to have a really bad scene that I'm like, oh, I'm going to fix it while we shoot or something. I don't believe in that, actually.
I'm glad to hear that. Do you feel like that's part of the fact that you're not really beholden to a studio system? You get to work outside and kind of go your own pace?
I don't know how the studio system works because I've never worked for them. Mm-hmm. So I have no idea how that works. I just know that I write screenplays, then, you know, I get notes from the producers, because even when you're out of the studio system, you get notes, you know, mm-hmm. and I work on it again and again and again. And then, you know, I get to a place where everyone's happy, and then we put the film, the financing together, usually out of Europe, and then we shoot the film. And then I do a reading with the actors. I see if there's something that stands out that doesn't work, which happens sometimes. And that's it, you know.
Let's talk about Lolo. And can you pitch us the movie? Give us the elevator pitch for it?
Listen, it's a French comedy. It talks about two things. It talks about, you know, women in their 40s finding love again and having to deal with children that don't want to leave home, like teenagers, because that's the character is a teenager, Lolo. And basically, it's also about sociopath and how they make your life miserable. In the film, it happens to be our own son who's a sociopath, which is really difficult, because I think you can eventually get rid of a you know, abusive sociopathic husband, mm-hmm. a coworker or friend or whatever, but you know, they can drive you to kill yourself, those people. So they're very dangerous. But when it happens to be your son, it's very screwed up, because how can you not love your son, you know, as a mother? I mean, obviously some people don't love their children, but sadly, but, you know, I think most, normal people would love their kid, you know, so it's a very difficult thing when the enemy is the closest thing to you, your flesh and blood, you know, what do you do? So it's basically the story, and it's a comedy, on a pretty dark subject matter, you know?
Yeah, very much.
I mean, it's kind of messed up, but, you know, some people think it's very scary. I think it's hilarious, but some people are scared of the character of Lolo, so that's pretty funny to me.
Definitely. I definitely found some scary stuff there in the movie. Absolutely. what was the... I mean, I read one thing that you said there was some inspiration from The Bad Seed and some other movies, but what was the initial idea? Where did that come from?
From my own insecurity as a mother. I mean, my son is the opposite of the character of Lolo in the film, you know. Mm-hmm. He's a very, he's full of empathy, sweet little thing, you know. Mm-hmm. He always takes care of the little kid in the classroom, you know, who's weaker or whatever. So he's very, very sweet. But, you know, even when you have a very sweet kid, you always question, because I see friends that have given everything to their children and the children turn on them. And it's really interesting. It's like, no matter what you do, do you do the right thing by loving your child unconditionally? Can you turn them into a monster? Or is it, you know, in The Bad Seed, basically the parents question the thing, you know, is it, was she born that way? Or what did we do wrong for her to be that way, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's always the question when you have a kid, it's like you could end up with someone you don't know, even if you do everything right. So it's an interesting concept, having children, because you never know who they are completely. They're their own thing, you know? So in the film, the character is really horrible, and it's so hard for her to see it.
Sure.
Like, she probably... It's happened many times what he's doing, and she can't see it. She refuses to see it in a way, and she's very responsible for it. In a way, she's responsible for her own misery, because she refuses to see, you know, how messed up he is. And she keeps on putting him on a pedestal. She never says no. She keeps on feeding him in a way, you know, as like feeding as like the breast and everything. There's a lot of funny kind of Freudian reference in the film. The eggs, the breast, you know, all that stuff.
Sure.
I just had fun doing that stuff. It's cute.
So how long ago did you start on this actual, on the writing, on the script, on the idea? How long ago was it? Do you know?
It was about 2.5 years ago.
So 2.5 years, and then this is, you know, coming out right now. So
yeah,
2.5 years in all.
Well, maybe three. You know what? Truth, 3 years ago I was writing. We had thought about it 3.5 years ago, and I was writing. Actually, it's more 3.5. But I wrote two other screenplays during that time as well. So
not quite a monopoly on your time. But what was your process like to get through this and to make this happen?
You know, we started working through the internet, like bouncing off ideas to create the skeleton, mm-hmm. because I always like to work that way. You know, I think it's the fastest way, smartest way to work. You don't go crazy and lose yourself into a wood. Like, you get, you know, you get the map of the woods, you create the map of the woods, you know where you're going, mm-hmm. completely, characters, story, from A to Z with A, B, C, D, that scene, that scene, that scene, that scene. And then when everything is really mapped out, you figured out all the characters, all the dynamics, that's when you start writing. And usually that part, I try to write quite fast. You want to write a scene in 1 hour or 2 hours or on one day, but you don't want to write one scene over a month, you know, because then it's all broken and you want it to be like you're hearing it, basically.
Well, you're experiencing it.
Yeah, exactly. You don't want it to, because I think then you cut the naturalism of the dialogue. I think dialogue is always better when it's flowing, you know, that way. And the way to make it flowing, to me, again, everyone's different, but the way to be flowy is to really do it, you know, boom, like that.
I think you've just changed my writing process. I was never conscious of that before, but that's a great observation.
But if, you know, when everything is sorted out, your characters are alive, you know, in your head. They exist. They're not just one-dimensional things anymore. And therefore, the dialogue flows because you know who they are, you know. And big work is really the figuring it out in the first place. So.
Sure. What about, I mean, you're as much an American as you are French, I imagine, at this point in your life. You've lived lots of different places. Are there different sensibilities you have to entertain when you're making a movie, when you're telling a story? Are there things that an American audience won't understand that a French one will, and vice versa?
You know, I don't think French American anymore. You know, I realize this. You know, humor on certain subjects matters. You know, relationship, all that stuff. I mean, it's pretty much very similar. You know, there's a few differences. You know, I have to say French can be a bit more crude. And enjoy it more and feel more comfortable with being super crude, you know, and that always makes me laugh, you know, in France, like how crazy crude people can be. Even like bourgeoisie is actually not very uptight. Mm-hmm. You know, you can have really, you know, weirdly enough, not that I'm saying Americans are uptight, they're not, but I think there's a certain kind of fun way of talking about sex in France that is very kind of playful. And you know, it depends what part of the population, but when you go into the, you know, like my parents were like May 68 kind of people, like really open-minded sexual revolution and all that. And those people are really kind of like very unsnobbish, very open-minded, very funny, you know, and they digress everything, you know, they don't, oh my God, they don't care about anything. You know, it's like great fun and they have no filter and they just speak up and, you know, and it's just interesting. And it's, I've rarely met this kind of a kind of crazy kind of like someone like my dad, I've never really met in the US, for example, you know, and my dad has lots of friends that are like him. So there's a whole like chunk of people that are like crazy French people that have been raised by, you know. The U.S. is different. I mean, there's great intellectuals in the U.S. and everything, you know, but they're less nutty, you know, in a way, you know. I mean, my dad is completely crazy and it's so funny, you know. Both my parents were nuts, you know, and I mean, not nuts in a bad way, nuts in a good way, you know. The fun way, super creative, super interested in art. I, you know, they dragged me to see everything, every movie, every art exhibition, every... From the age of 5, I was dragged to see, you know, to the Cinémathèque. I think I saw, you know, my first Bergman film. I must have been 8 or something.
That is not a quintessential American experience, that's for sure.
Well, you know, I don't know. But, you know, it's not the quintessential French experience either. Trust me, it's pretty unusual. But you know, I have to say, like, that's very Parisian intellectual kind of thing where you bring the kids. There's no, I mean, now, you know, everyone's so scared to show kids more intelligent stuff, you know. And in a way, you know, I'm like, oh, okay. You know, it's not for their age, but like, it doesn't need to be, I'm not talking scary movie or horror or stuff like that. That's awful for children, but like more advanced stuff for their age. I don't think it hurts children actually.
Well, look, I know we're running out of time here. So I want to ask one more thing before I let you go. You've had this amazing career. You've worked outside the studio system, making your own vision and making your own stories. Do you have another piece of advice for writers out there that are listening now for how they could get closer to your career?
Oh, was my career an example of, I don't know. listen, I was very resilient. I was not giving up. No matter how people put me down, and trust me, a lot of people, especially because I was an actress originally, you know, so it wasn't easy. I was really told many, many times, even by friends and people that wish me good stuff, you know, like even friend of mine directors were like, oh, why are you becoming a writer? It's silly. You're so pretty, you know, you should be an actress only. You're going to kill the dream. The people are not going to fantasize about you anymore if you're directing and writing. You know, they're not going to want you in movies anymore, which is a bit true. I mean, I don't work with many people anymore, but I don't really care. But, you know, it's life. You know, that's the way it is. It's all those things that were negative, 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 you know. And it took me 20 years, you know, between my first screenplay and my first film. So it was this constant struggle. And I think the only advice I have is to not give up. If that's really your calling and something you really want to do. But it's only if you're truly passionate that you don't give up. Because truly, if I wasn't passionate about writing, I would have given up because it was too hard. But that's the way it is. Life is hard. I mean, I was not expecting to be easy ever. And I had very low expectation for my life when I grew up because I was coming out of nowhere, nothing. My parents were super poor and stuff. So I was expecting very, very, very little from this life. So in the end, you know, I'm doing okay. You know, I'm pretty happy. I had no dreams because actually I believe for a woman to become a director at the time that I grew up was so unusual that that dream was not even, I didn't even permit myself to have it. So it was, yeah, but in the end I started not, I never dreamt. I just moved forward.
So it was one step at a time.
One step at a time, like a big mountain and you just look like one foot away from you and not up the mountain, you know.
Well, that's great. That's a great place to wrap it up. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thanks to Julie Delpy, and thanks to you for listening to this podcast. If you like this podcast, let us know by leaving us a review on iTunes or wherever you grab your podcast, even just a little rating to tell us that you're enjoying it. You don't have to even say anything. And thank you to those of you who are already doing that for us. Until next time, thanks.